All right, let's talk about something important. The fundamental theorem of algebra. It sounds important, certainly along the way. And this is what the fundamental theorem of algebra says. It says that every polynomial that has degree greater than one, greater than or equal to one, has at least one zero, where the zero may be a complex number. Now, we are, because of the COVID situation here, we don't have the time to explore the complex number side of things, but those are the numbers that occur, like if you have a parabola that does not intersect the x-axis and you go looking for the roots, the places where it does intersect the x-axis, the answers that you get are classified as complex numbers, okay? So the corollary to that, something that is implied by that theorem, is that every polynomial function of degree n greater than or equal to 1 has exactly n zeros, including multiplicities. So if we have a degree 5, there should be 5 zeros. Those zeros may be nice whole numbers. They could be integers. They could be rational numbers. If one of them is an irrational number, then we know that there's at least two that are irrational numbers and they're closely related. And if one of them, it turns out, is a complex number, then there are at least two complex roots. Those always come in pairs as well. Okay, so we'll try to keep this down to the parts that we can actually have a discussion about without talking about complex numbers. So, my tips on identifying all of these roots are, number one, to use a graph. Use the rational root theorem to get started. We didn't specifically talk about the rational root theorem either, but we can tell from this graph, because this hits at negative 2 and positive 1, we would expect that x plus 2 is going to be a factor and that x minus 1 is going to be a factor. This is a degree 4, so that at least would get us down to a quadratic at that point. Once you have extracted one of the roots, work on what is left. Don't go back to the original starting point. Okay, and remember that once you get down to a quadratic, you have the quadratic, you got lots of quadratic tools available. All right, so we're going to try to solve this equation. It may be difficult to see, but it says x to the fourth minus 3x cubed plus x squared plus 15x minus 14 equals 0. And we're going to try to solve this by breaking this apart into four different pieces if we can, because it is degree 4. And I'll start by trying to divide out an x plus 2. Okay, I'm pretty sure that this is going to work here, okay, because of what I see in the graph. I'm try to shrink this down a little bit and get it out of the way. Okay. But actually leave it someplace because I need to know what those numbers are. All right, in this process, we've seen this several times now. X to the fourth must mean that's an x cubed, which makes this a 2x cubed. But my x cubed, I was supposed to end up with negative 3 of those x cubed, so this must have been a minus 5 x cubed there, which would make this a minus 5 x squared, and that would make this a minus 10 x squared. Okay. But I am supposed to have just 1 x squared, which must mean this was an 11 x squared, and if that's an 11 x squared, then this must have been a plus 11 x. And this would have been a plus 22x, but those were supposed to add up to 15x's, so it must be a minus 7x right there, which would make this a minus 7, and this a minus 14, which is what I was shooting for. So far now, I've used my graph to help me figure out that this factors into an x plus 2 times an x cubed minus 5x squared plus 11x minus 7 equals 0. Okay. Now, I'm going to go back to the graph because I've still got an x cubed here and I haven't used the x minus 1 yet. And this is the part where it says don't undo or don't ignore what you've already accomplished. I'm now going to try to take the x minus 1 out of that part. If it came out of the whole thing, it should come out of this part that's left. So I'll load up my x minus 1 for the division. And I have my x cubed. And if that's an x cubed, then this must be an x squared, which makes that a minus x squared. But these were supposed to add up to, I'm supposed to have negative 5 x squareds. So this must have been a negative 4 x squared there, which means this is a minus 4 x. And this is a 4 x. But these were supposed to add up to 11 x. So this must have been a plus 7x to give me that, which means this must have been a plus 7, and this would be a minus 7, which is what I wanted. So now my problem has become, I need to see what I had up there to begin with. I have the x minus 2 or x plus 2 that I pulled out first, and then the x minus 1. And what's left is an x squared minus 4x plus 7, all equals 0. So my zero product property, as I'm going along here, I know from this first part, to make this happen, either x plus 2 has to equal 0, or x minus 1 has to equal 0, or x squared minus 4x plus 7 has to equal 0. It's quadratic, so factoring is a possibility, except that my graph doesn't indicate that this crosses the x-axis anyplace else. Okay. So I suspect what I actually have here are some complex number solutions. It won't factor. I can't find two numbers that multiply together to give me 7 and add together to give me negative 4. So I'm going to hit this one with the quadratic formula to find my last two roots. And that's going to be a 4 plus or minus the square root of 16 minus 4 times 1 times 7 all over 2 times 1, which is 4 plus or minus the square root of 16 minus 28 over 2, which is a 4 plus or minus the square root of negative 12 over 2, and the negative under the square root confirms that this is a complex root. In fact, there's two complex roots here, closely related because they both came out of the quadratic formula, and we haven't had the time to talk about how we would write that notation, so we're, for now, just going to leave it like that and say that two of my roots are not real numbers. My other two roots are x equals negative 2 and x equals positive 1.